pleasure to introduce Dr. Julio Durán. He works at the National Commission for Atomic Energy in Buenos Aires, Argentina, and he is an expert on solar cells. So thank you for coming to the ICOM.
Thank you. Good morning. Well, I will try to give you, in these two lectures, an overview of what is happening in the world about photovoltaic solar energy conversion. It would be like a potpourri. I would talk about several topics related with photovoltaics. I hope it will not be boring for me. This is a summary of the contents of the two lectures. I will mention things about energy in general. Afterwards, I will speak about solar energy and give you some numbers. Then I will mention the materials and devices, solar cell devices. Some brief comments also about pollution and energy payback. I will explain later what is the energy payback in photovoltaic. In the last part of my talk, in the second lecture, I will speak about the terrestrial and space applications. And finally, I will give you an overview of our activities in the National Atomic Energy Commission in Argentina. Well, the photographs is to amenize the talk. These are some comments about energy. Energy is not a basic need for man. Air, water, and food are basic needs, but it's essential for satisfying those needs. The requirement of a man is 10 megajoules per day. Nowadays, we are using 50 times that energy. The question is, will we have enough energy to satisfy the demand of a stabilized population of 40,000 million inhabitants? That's the main question regarding with energy. Some milestone in the evolution of the human being on the Earth. Biomass began to be used 500,000 years ago for heat and cooking. The first use of external source in a planned way was solar with agriculture, which is relatively new. Then appear the wind for transport and sailing ships. Windmills appear almost in this era. Hydropower. For mechanical energy, in the year 500, coal, 1400. Afterwards, in the Industrial Revolution in 1769, the oil is in the 19th century, oil, electricity, and nuclear at the half of the 20th century. You can interrupt in any moment you consider it necessary to ask or comment anything. This is another important point regarding energy. Till the end of the 18th century, before the Industrial Revolution, the required energy was proportional to population. Everyone has the energy available per capita was similar all over the world. After the Industrial Revolution, there appeared other parameters, and the development was driven by economical and military development. This produces the problems with the distribution of the energy and of the all the things. And this produces a positive feedback that increases the distribution differences. Nowadays, a fourth of the world population consumes over 3/4 of the commercial energy in the world. All the sources we used, or energy sources we use, are the origin of the sun, the earth, or the moon's gravitational attraction. This is a list of the primary sources of energy. Hydraulic, wind, solar, ocean, these are direct, and the indirect are crude oil, natural gas, coal, minerals, geothermal, or through photosynthesis. Most of them we will see in the next slide. Also, the origin is the sun. We can divide these primary sources in renewables and non-renewables. Here we can see a classification in different types of sources. The non-renewables, the fossil fuels, nuclear for fission and for fusion in the future. The origin is the sun in the case of fossil fuels, the earth in the case of nuclear or geothermal, and again the sun for the renewable sources, the solar, wind, biomass, hydraulic. Also the oceanic are related to the sun, except the tides that is provided by the gravitational attraction of the moon. This is the world primary energy distribution by 2007. I'm sorry, some of the graphs I will show are not from last year. I have had problems to get more new information. Almost 3/4 of the total primary sources is provided by fossil fuels. We have here nuclear, 6%, biomass, 10%, only 2% with hydro, and others 1%. Only the three orders of magnitude. In this graph we can see annual world consumption, how much oil, order of magnitude we have in the world, how much gas, how much uranium, how much coal. The main resources are here, in uranium and coal. And we have a lot of solar energy. But as we have seen in the previous graph, we are only using the non-renewable sources, those which we have not too much to maintain the consumption, the present consumption. This is installed electric power generation with renewables by 2008. We are talking about the total in the world, less than 300 gigawatts, over a total capacity in the world of 4,700 gigawatts, about 5 or 6% of the total energy is with the renewables, and all the other requirements are satisfied with non-renewables. The main contributions with renewables are in wind and hydro. In this graph, it's not included the large-scale hydroelectric stations because these are considered conventional. We will talk a lot during both lectures about PV, but I would like to mention here which are the targets that are estimated in the International Energy Agency about the contribution of PV in the electric generation in the world. This expects to have a 10% contribution by the year 2050 and about 2 or 3 or 4% by the year 2030. All the changes with the energy sources are very slow during this history. But let's go to solar energy now. I'd like to give you some idea. I'm sorry, some of the graphs are in Spanish. This is energy distribution in watt per square meter and nanometer. This is wavelength. This is characteristic spectrum of the solar radiation. This is black body at 6,000 Kelvin. AMO or AM0 is the radiation outside the atmosphere. Is this curve, red curve. And this is a typical spectrum in the surface of the Earth. This is called AM1.5. This means that the distance that the radiations AM is defined by 1 divided the cosine P. The cosine P is the angle between the radiation and the normal to the surface. This gives an idea of how much atmosphere is traveling. How much distance is traveling? Sorry, is traveling through the atmosphere, 1.5 times the atmosphere. A typical value for the outside the atmosphere is 1,366 watts per square meter, and the surface of the Earth, a typical value is 1,000 watts per square meter. What is the spectral distribution? Interesting is ultraviolet, the visible 41%, the 51% is infrared. Which are the main characteristics of solar energy? It's an exhaustive source and essentially non-polluting. This should be emphasized. It's essentially non-polluting. The generation doesn't pollute, but due to the construction of the devices, there is pollution. We have to study all the cycle from the construction to the end of the life of the device to say if it's or not polluting. The problem with the solar energy that is intermittent and with low density. The intermittent requires storage, like batteries, standard batteries, or in the future using hydrogen as an intermediary fuel. The other possibility is not to have storage, but to inject the solar electricity generated with solar energy into the grid, and you provide grid electricity to the grid when you have solar radiation, and you take from the grid when you do not have solar radiation. Typical power at moon is 1 kilowatt per square meter, and the yearly mean value is 3 to 4 kilowatt hour per square meter per day. This is the total energy you have in a square meter per day, the mean value during the year. It's different in winter than in summer. The direct conversion of solar energy may be directed to thermal, photothermal conversion, photovoltaic conversion directed to the solar to electricity generation. An indirect conversion of solar energy is the case of wind and hydraulic energy I mentioned before. We will only talk about photovoltaic conversion from now on. I mentioned that solar energy is low density. This is an example to show it's low density, but not so low density. It's an example in Argentina. Mean solar radiation at the north of Rio Colorado, this is latitude of 39 degrees south, is 4.5 kilowatt hour per square meter per day. If you use standard values for the efficiency of the conversion from solar energy to electricity, 15%, a land occupation typical for a central power with solar, 50%, and you consider the electrical demand of Argentina in the year 2010, you can conclude that the required area is about 1,000 square kilometers. If you compare this with the lake of Yacyretá hydroelectric plant, this is Argentina and Paraguay hydroelectric plant with 3,100 megawatts, this area represents only 60% of the lake area, and it will generate 6.7 times the energy generated by this hydroelectric plant. It's a low density, but it depends on which plant you compare it. With a nuclear plant, it's low density. With an oil plant, it's low density, but not with an hydroelectric plant. We talk now about the devices that are used for the generation of solar electricity directly from the sun. The origin of the silicon of the solar cells is in 1958. The first use was in a satellite, in Vanguard 1. A PV module with a 10% efficiency was included in this satellite in 1958. And in 1973, we are talking about the first crisis, the first oil crisis, only space and military uses were available. The sources were very expensive, and there were no uses for the rest. With the oil crisis of the 70s, there appeared the terrestrial uses. Milestone may be mentioned in the 90s when new impetus appeared due to ecological issues. Basically, the solar cell is a diode, it's a PN junction with silicon doped with phosphorus, 5 valence electrons, 1 free electron, and boron for the p-type region where you generate the hole. To have the two regions, a space charge region is generated in the interface where a very strong electrical field appears. This electric field is the one that permits to separate the electron of the hole and the holes you generate by illuminating the device. When you illuminate the device, a pair of electron and a hole appears, and if the electron can reach the junction, the electric field will separate it from the hole. And this is the electron that will be available for an external circuit. This is schematic view of the bands in a semiconductor. This is the conduction band. This is the valence band. This is the region of the space charge region where a very high electric field appears. The bands are bending here. This is the case in equilibrium. The Fermi level or quasi-Fermi level is the same on both sides of the junction and is associated to the levels of the holes and the electrons on both sides. When you illuminate and generate an electron and a hole by illumination, this band bending is modified and there appears a voltage here that is the one is used for the external circuit. This voltage allows the electrons to pass from one side to the other side of the junction, and these electrons are going to an electrical load external to the device. This is the basic principles of the functioning of a solar cell. Which materials are used for solar cells? All of them are semiconductors. You have of the column form semiconductors, in particular silicon, and also germanium in some combinations used. Some 3-5 semiconductors like gallium arsenide, or thermally compounds like indium gallium arsenide. Also 2-6 semiconductors, cadmium telluride, or more complex semiconductors like copper, indium, gallium, diselenide. As I mentioned before, the dopants for silicon are boron of column 3 and phosphorus from column 5. In this graph we can see where the energy gap of each semiconductor is located in comparison with the spectrum. Here's silicon, here's germanium, here's gallium arsenide, gallium indium phosphide, gallium sulfide. But the energy higher than the energy gap may be absorbed by the semiconductor. Higher energy, lower wavelength. All these wavelength may be absorbed by silicon, and this one cannot be absorbed. Here you have a compromise. If you use a very low energy gap like germanium, you absorb a lot of photons, but you have very low voltage. Voltage is associated with the gap. This difference is limited by the gap. As you want to have power, you need a compromise between current and voltage, and the optimum values are here, gallium arsenide, silicon, in this zone. Another way that you can see this is that any photon that is absorbed in the semiconductor generates only one electron hole pair. If you have a lot of energy, this case, for example, in silicon, these photons that have 2 or 3 times the energy of the gap generate only one electron hole. Most of the energy is not used for generating a pair and this transforming in heat. It's a thermal process, but that doesn't generate a current to the external circuit. I don't know if it's clear, the idea. I will not go into detail with the physics of the problem, but I would like to mention some parameters that are of interest when you study the device, and when you design a device for solar application. One of the important points is the characteristics of the convection and valence bands of the semiconductors. Silicon is an indirect semiconductor. The transition from a valence band to the conduction band is an indirect transition. It requires a phonon. It requires an interaction with the material that makes this absorption less important than in the case of direct semiconductor like gallium arsenide. This can be seen, you will see in another graph, which is the characteristic associated with this direct or indirect gap. Crystalline silicon has been during the history the main used semiconductor for solar cells. Why crystalline silicon? It's not the best material. There are better materials. It has several advantages. It's the second most abundant element in the Earth's crust. Only 1/4 of the elements in the Earth's crust is silicon. Has a very uniform characteristic, electrical, chemical, mechanical. The devices you can obtain are relatively high stability and efficiency, and this is a very important point. It's highly developed technology and established industry associated with electronic. It has some disadvantages. It's an expensive material to purify. The silicon is not available alone in the earth. The purification of silicon is expensive. It's expensive from the point of view of cost. It's expensive from the point of view of energy. You need a lot of energy to purify the silicon. Electronic properties are not optimum. It's an indirect gap. You require, you have a low absorption coefficient. You require material, more material than in the case of direct semiconductors. And the usual ways of growing the material don't allow to have a larger dimension of the cells. This is a problem associated also with cost. The main physical problems or parameters associated with the solar cells are the absorption. You want to absorb the radiation, convert into carriers, electrons and holes, and the recombination. You generate an electron and hole, and if these electron and holes recombinate before arriving to the junction, you will not have this electron and hole for the external circuit. The absorption in semiconductors have different characteristics, interband between different bands, phonon-assisted absorption, indirect transition, as I mentioned in silicon, intraband transition, electrons that move inside the same band, and others, exciton formation, band localized state transitions. All these define absorption coefficient. The one is useful for electricity generation is the interband direct transition, and also the indirect interband transitions. This is the absorption coefficient of several materials. This is a wavelength, and this is a log of the absorption coefficient. So you can see the direct materials, once you have arrived to the energy gap, in the case of gallium arsenide, they go up very quickly. This means that only a few micrometers of material are necessary to absorb the radiation. In the case of silicon, that is an indirect gap, it don't goes up so quickly. You need more material. For a wavelength near the band gap, you need a lot of micrometers to absorb the radiation. The other process is recombination. You don't want to have recombination in the device, but the recombination exists. You have to limit it. This, rather than the recombination, is a recombination of an electron and a hole emitting light. Auger recombination is energy is transferred to an electron hole. In this case, the energy is given to this electron. And short-lived hole recombination is a recombination through a localized defect. If you have defects in the material, these defects generates levels inside the band gap, and some recombinations are through these defects in the band area. This is so some basic equation. I will not go into them. I will also only mention that these are Poisson equation regarding the electric charge, the current density equation where the drift current associated with the electric electric charge or electric field, the diffusion current, and the continuity equation where the generation or recombination appear. If one solves in a simplified way this equation, you can see that an equivalent circuit for the solar cell may be presented or established. This equivalent circuit has a current source, photogeneration. This is associated to the electron holes generated by light. Nonlinear impedance associated with the PN junction is a diode, essentially a diode. And several resistances, series resistance associated essentially with the contacts, and the parallel resistance, there is some current that can go through the junction due to defects or hole pinholes, and finally the load. The current voltage curve associated with this equivalent circuit may be written in this way. It's a photogenerated current. This is the current through the diode. And this is the current through the parallel resistance. Finally, we have this type of IV curve. This is the dark conditions, the diode. Usually in solar, we view the graph in the other side. The usual graph for a diode is in the first quadrant, but we usually put it in the, we change this axis, and we usually put the generation in the first quadrant. As I mentioned, this is the IV curve for a solar cell, has several important points. The short circuit current here, open circuit voltage here, and the zone where the power is maximum, maximum power point, you want to work here with the solar cell. The efficiency defined as the power in this point divided by the solar radiation incident power. There are several fundamental limits with the efficiency of a solar cell. photons with energy less than the energy gap are not absorbed. Photons with higher energy than the energy gap produce only one pair electron hole. I mentioned before that the additional energy is not useful for the external the external load. It's transformed into heat. Radiative recombination, we can not avoid the radiative recombination of an electron and hole of in the valence and conduction band. Also, Auger recombination is not avoidable. Absorption of photon through free carriers is also a recombination that is present in any case. There are other additional losses in real devices, recombination through defects, ohmic losses, shadows produced by the contact grid. The device is a PN junction with a contact grid in the front side. The solar radiation passes through this contact grid. The contact grid produces shadow on the device. And this is solar radiation that it's not used in the device. Reflectivity in the front surface and non-complete radiation absorption. If part of the radiation passed through the device is not used for the generation. There are several strategies for minimizing these losses. Some of them are associated with passivation. The surfaces of the material of the semiconductor have a lot of traps. You have to avoid recombination there. This is the way to do that is passivating the surface. We have to complete these dangling bones in the surface to avoid recombination there. Another thing that is usually used is light trapping. If we can, if the light inside the material goes not in this direction, but in this direction, you can permit many reflections in both surfaces, and this is called light trapping. Well, this gives rise to structures like this one, where you have microstructures in the surface with pyramids, inverted pyramids in the surface. Localized diffusion is not the same. The diffusion is not a complete PN junction in the sense I mentioned before. It has different diffusion in different zones of the material, also in the backside. These highly doped zones are the recombination is very high there. You have to limit the surface associated with these high doping zones. Well, all these are strategies to minimize the losses in the device. This is a solar cell with about 25% efficiency. The standard silicon solar cell have 15, 16, 17% efficiency. Another strategy, we mentioned that the energy gap is in some way a problem. You don't use this part of the spectrum, you use, but not in the best condition, this part of the spectrum. A way to maximize the efficiency is to combine in the same device several solar cells, several materials with different band gap. Some materials that use this part of the spectrum, the other one, the middle cell, uses this part of the spectrum, and the third one uses this part of the spectrum. Can make an engineering problem. You can design the device to optimize different zones of the spectrum. In this case, it's a triple junction solar cell with three cells. These structures are very complicated. They have a lot of layers. not only with the cells, but in the between the cells, you need a lot of layers to couple the solar cells. The theoretical values with only one semiconductor is 37%, and with three semiconductors, 56%. This is at present, this is used especially for space application because it gives very high efficiency, but are very expensive. The position techniques are very complex, and the device is very expensive. The final part of this first lecture, I will mention some points about the production processes. Any question about the theoretical part? So clear or nothing is clear. Any of both. These are the steps from the base material, quartz or sand, to the systems. In the case of silicon, I will show you silicon, I will mention a couple of things in the last part about other materials. First part, you have to obtain metallurgical silicon, metallurgical grade silicon. This is 99% pure. This material has to be purified to get the semiconductor grade or an electronic grade silicon. In this case, we are talking about impurities, one in a million or 10 to the 9, one atom in 10 to the 9 atoms of silicon impurity. That's the order of magnitude of the impurity in a semiconductor grade silicon. After that, you have to grow the ingots in a crystalline, multicrystalline or single crystalline ingots. You cut the wafers. After that, you produce the cells, interconnect the cells, and get the modules, and finally the system where you connect the solar modules to the external. Semiconductor grade silicon is the most costly step of the whole process. The standard process is a Siemens process. It's based in trichlorosilane distillation. This is it's a chemical process. And the original metallurgical silicon is about $1 or $2 a kilogram. You get finally $60 or $70 per kilogram for semiconductor grade silicon. There are some alternatives with physical process instead of chemical processes that allow to get some intermediate grade silicon, more impurity than in more impurity than in semiconductor grade, but much less impurity than the metallurgical silicon. This is appropriate only for solar cells, not for electronic applications. Well, a brief summary of the silicon wafer production, the ingot growing. We will see the alternatives, cut in blocks, wafers cut by wire, metrology finally. The alternatives for growing the crystalline silicons are the Chukotsky grow, is the standard method for growing single crystalline silicon. And the cast method for producing multicrystalline silicon. This is a columnar crystalline material. It's multicrystalline, but when you cut all the, when they cut the wafers, all the columns of the crystals are in this direction. This means that you can think the whole device of, as a set of devices that are single crystalline. In the direction of the current inside the device, they are essentially single crystalline. The problems of the gray borders is that you have recombination there. This material produces cells with less efficiency than the single crystalline material, but it's less expensive. The silicon solar cell production, the main process is the PN junction formation, we will see in another graph. And the anti-reflective coating deposition is another important step of the cell production, and the deposition of contacts. Diffusion process is produced in a furnace at about 1,000 degrees centigrade. This is the reaction with the standard phosphorus, oxygen, chlorine-free liquid source. You bubble through this source and transfer this source to the inside the furnace, where this reaction is produced, and finally you introduce phosphorus in the material, generating the N junction. This diffusion is the wafers, the silicon wafers you introduce into the furnace, are P-type silicon. The P-type silicon is produced during the growing of the crystal in the Tchaikovsky method, for example. And you produce here the the N region to produce the NP diode or NP junction. After the cells are produced, you have to interconnect them. Each cell produces 0.6 volts and, for example, 3 amperes. You have to interconnect them in series in order to obtain voltages that are useful for charging, for example, a battery. These are connected in series by soldering the backside and interconnecting the backside of the one cell to the front side of the next one, and you produce this type of modules with, for example, 36 solar cells interconnected in series. This module have also a protection to allow to appropriate to use in the environment condition that they will be used. I think this is the last slide of the first lecture, only to show you some more sophisticated devices that have been studied in different labs in the world. Nanomaterials, is everywhere nowadays. quantum dot arrays, this is an array of semiconductors in an insulator matrix. These are quantum similar, quantum wise instead of quantum dots, another type of. There's copper, indium, gallium, diselenide, flexible cells. These are deposited on flexible substrates. there are also some organic cells being developed and some electrolytes, photosensitive anode plus electrolyte. These are called dye-synthesis, dye-solar cells. And also a combination of photovoltaic standard solar cells or quasi-standard solar cells, but combined with concentrators. If you concentrate the light in small areas by mirrors, for example, you can generate per square meter of solar cell a lot of energy, not one. You will receive in the solar cell not 1 kilowatt per square meter, but for example 100 kilowatt per square meter. You can use in this case very sophisticated devices because the area requires much less, and this is allows to. We have to put the. Well, this is our several strategies that have been developed in order to look for low-cost devices in some cases, or for new technologies that will be available in the future. In the second part, we'll talk about the applications and something about the market and so on. I think this is the last of the first lecture. Well, we can stop here.
Celdas solares en un lugar ocupa más o menos lo mismo que el lago de Argentina en Paraguay y le da 6.7 más de energía. El problema es disponibilidad, ¿no?
The question is regarding the area required. When I compare the required area for a PV application and with the lake of a hydroelectric power plant. The problem is not availability, the problem today is cost. The areas are available in our country a lot, and all over the world in different countries. Perhaps I haven't understood the question.
Me refiero a la disponibilidad energética, es decir, el lago siempre tendría, por así decirlo, agua acumulada. El sol puede estar oculto, etc.
You are talking about the intermittence or the no availability, continual availability of the, yes. Yes, this is correct. The intermittence is a problem with solar energy. If you introduce, you can introduce to a grid a limited quantity of energy that provides from an intermittent source. Typical values are 10-15%, the limit of the electricity you can provide with the intermittent source. You have to combine different sources with different characteristics to compensate the variability of each one. In the future, if the human being wants to go to solar energy, storage. A reliable storage method is required. A very interesting possibility is hydrogen. To generate hydrogen with solar energy and to use hydrogen as a fuel. The problem is that today it's not cost effective solar energy when you add the problem of the generating hydrogen, the cost goes rise again. But It's probably a solution for the second part of the of this century. Questions or comments?
Okay, I think we can go for a short break and then we continue with the next lecture.